Our guests for this program are two women who served our nation during World War II. Stay tuned to hear some of their exciting and dramatic experiences during that time.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program by and for seniors, and devoted to exploring the many facets of those better years of our lives. The name of our program is inspired by a quotation from Robert Browning. Grow old along with me, the best is yet to be, the last of life for which the first was made. Now, sit back and enjoy a program made especially to provide seniors with useful information, plus some lighter moments to brighten your day.
I'd like to introduce to you U.S. Marine Corps Women's Reserve Tech Sergeant Josephine Hutchings McCall and First Lieutenant Caroline Morrison Garrett, a dietitian in the Army Medical Corps. Thank you so much, both of you ladies, for agreeing to come and talk with me today. And I think I'll start with you, Joe, because you enlisted first. Would you tell us when and why?
And I enlisted March the 8th in 1943. My father had met some Marines in the town and talked to them, and they had told him the women Marines had just been authorized to join the Corps, and he thought it would be a wonderful experience for me. So I talked my sister into joining with me, and we both joined.
Where did you have to be tested in those days? Or?
Yes, we had to go. We lived in Pocatello, Idaho at the time, and we had to go to Salt Lake City for examinations, written, physical, and oral. And out of 20 who went down, there were 6 of us who passed.
Oh my goodness. And where were you first stationed then?
We had boot camp at Hunter College in New York City, and then went to Cherry Point, North Carolina, the Marine Corps Air Station, the first 18 women who went down. We were with those first 18 with 10,000 men at the station.
You must have been celebrities.
We had to march everywhere we went. We were not allowed on our own.
You had an escort.
We had women officers who escorted us.
Did they do actual basic training like the men had?
We did a lot of marching. We did exercises, physical exercises, but we did not have to crawl under barbed wire or over high poles and such.
Just to be healthy. Did you have to learn to shoot? Or?
No, we didn't have to learn to shoot.
Now, your first job that you had was in California, was it?
Well, they put us to work every place we went, and I would do secretarial work. But the first real major job I had was when we went to Mojave, California, the Marine Corps Air Station there. And I was a secretary to the commanding officer of the station. And when our station sergeant major retired, they made me the acting station sergeant major there. So I had that for quite a while.
Somebody told me that your sister was in the same office.
My sister was with me. We joined together and were never separated. She became the station editor of the newspaper, which was called the Jackrabbit, and she did report to me.
And then you had something that you did on the side, because you grew up playing the piano. You're self-taught, I think, pianist, mostly, and you and your sister became involved in entertaining the troops, did you?
Yes, we both played duets. We grew up playing duets together, and when we got to Mojave, they had two grand pianos, and we played with the 14-piece band there, and we would play for dances sometimes. We would play at the officers' club sometimes. And then we were invited to play at the Hollywood Canteen in Los Angeles, which was quite a prestigious USO for the servicemen.
That was where a lot of the movie stars went and danced.
The movie stars operated this. They would provide food for the service people who came there. But we were invited to play one weekend there, our band, and my sister and I were also invited to do two piano numbers during the weekend. We alternated with Kay Kaiser and his band of renown.
Oh my goodness.
And met many wonderful people there.
On your off time, what did you get any free time to being in Southern California to go see the sights?
We had liberty. The more you got advanced in rate, the better liberty you got. And I got to the point where I had liberty every night and every weekend.
Somewhere along the line, I think I read in a newspaper article about you that being so few women on the base and so many men, you had a lot of invitations.
Yes, when we first went to Cherry Point, North Carolina, after more women came in, they started giving us a little more freedom. And there was only one place you could go, and that was to the PX, where the movie was there. And they would show two movies per night, but with so many men and so few women, we had the opportunity to date two or three times a night to different ones. And sometimes we would see the same movie twice, but it was a lot of fun.
For the most part of your time in the service, then, were you dealing with soldiers who had been in combat, or were they more like soldiers who were receiving training and that sort of thing, or handling the business end of the military?
Now, we worked at the Marine Corps Air Station, where they would have three units of air units, squadrons at a time, would come into the station, some preparing to go out to fight, others coming in from the war. But oftentimes, a lot of the squadrons that went out, not too many of them came back during the very severe times of the war. But it was a constant turnover of air personnel. But the women on the base did the jobs that the men could do, like packing the parachutes, like photography, like handling the control tower and the weather people. All of those things, the women could handle those things and free up the men to go do the fighting.
What were you doing the day the war ended?
The day the war ended, my sister and I were they had given us a week up in the mountains at Big Bear Lake. They gave the women a week rest and relaxation each year. And we were up there when the war ended, and we were so excited. They brought us back to the station very rapidly, and they closed down the station, locked it down, would let no one in and no one out, and they had a big celebration on the station.
Now, Caroline, you enlisted later, and tell us how you happened to get into
the army. I had no intentions of going into the service, but I had a professor when I was a senior in college who sent the whole class down to the basement of the post office to take a civil service exam. She said with the war on, we would all have to do that sooner or later. So one Saturday morning, we sat for 3 hours in the steaming hot room in the basement and filled in page after page after page of multiple questions. And I didn't think it mattered much one way or another. The only way I could ever explain the results was that I just hadn't taken it very seriously. But a few weeks later, I had a letter from the War Department saying that I had passed the exam and was one of 16 from throughout the United States who would be student and apprentice dietitians at Walter Reed, the Army Medical Center, for a year, after which we would be commissioned lieutenants in the Army.
And?
And it was a very hard decision to make because we had our choice. You didn't have to take it, but you were signing up for the duration of the war plus 6 months. Well, now we know how it all came out, but in those days, that could have been years. You had no idea what you were signing up.
So what made you go ahead and sign up?
Well, we were all very patriotic. Everyone wanted to do their part. It's hard to explain to people today, mm-hmm. don't you think so, Jill?
Yes.
We all wanted to do our part. And the fellow I'd been dating for a couple years had been killed the previous spring in an air crash, and I felt it was kind of up to me to complete what he had started. And of course, the university put me under a lot of pressure to take it, because since there were only 16 from throughout the country, they were very anxious for me to do it. But I think from the very beginning, I knew that I was going to do it. We all wanted to do our part.
Now, at Walter Reed, you were the position, you've written a book here, and it's very good. I didn't read all of it, but I read probably half of it flipping through. And it's interesting to me that the job that you had there was ludicrous, because you were put into a ward with paraplegics. You had to be the authority on what they were served.
Yes.
And yet you were also involved with serving the top brass. General Pershing, who was up on the penthouse, and Patton and Eisenhower and all the hierarchy who came in, you were responsible for their menus as well. And can you just briefly tell us, first of all, about the paraplegics and what was involved in
their
menus?
The men were all paralyzed from wherever a bullet had struck them in the back. I still remember Al Arena, who could only move his head, and said he had to survive because his only brother had been killed and he was all his mother had left. Mm. And it was the first time they had ever tried to rehabilitate these type of patients. And what they were eating was very, very important, because they could move so little, they got very bad infections. So it was my job to get the lab slips and know whose plasma protein was falling, and particularly look after those patients to get them to eat something. And when I was working with paraplegics after I was in the Army at Kennedy General in Memphis, Tennessee, I had 3 German prisoners of war in the ward kitchen to help me serve all these meals. And we missed a lot of our meals, because I'd have to go around and say to a fellow, well, you didn't eat very much today. Would you have a milkshake if I spiked it? Would you eat a fried egg? So I missed a lot of my own meals, because it would take me hours sometimes to talk some of these fellows into good nutrition, which was so important to their well-being.
And then tell a little bit about the officers and what you had to do with them. General Pershing,
General Pershing had lived at Walter Reed in a penthouse on the top floor for many years. By the time I knew him, he was a very elderly man. You'd read in the paper that General Marshall had been out to discuss the war with General Pershing, but General Pershing really wasn't up to that. And I never had any trouble with the officers, but their relatives could drive you crazy. And General Pershing's sister, Miss May Pershing, met with me every morning at 10 o'clock to plan the general's menus for the day. And she had lunch with him and dinner with him. And things like, we had sugar shakers that had red tops and black tops. And she insisted that she have the black top at noon and the general have red, and night vice versa. And of course, the tray carriers knew that, and so they would switch them. And then the next morning, she'd say to me, "I don't know what's wrong with you people, that you can't even get the right sugar shaker on the tray."
It's a little mind-boggling dealing with such different types of situations.
Oh, you had to deal with all kinds of situations, and of course, you couldn't say anything back. You just had to
and
take
then,
it.
The Army regulations about the garbage, that the paraplegic ward had too much garbage.
Well, every ward in the hospital, after dinner at night, when the garbage cans were taken down to the sub-basement, they were weighed. And this was supposed to be a way of keeping track of the waste and trying to improve conditions in the hospital. And I'd only been on the ward a couple of weeks when I had a communication from the commanding officer that we had the highest rate of garbage of any ward in the hospital. And I had 1 week to correct the situation or I would report to him personally. Well, these three Germans didn't speak any English. I spoke no German. And we stood by the garbage can, and I kept saying, "Too much, too much, too much." And finally, one of them said, "Yeah, yeah, he got it." The next night, we had baked beans, and we served the dinner. And a few minutes later, all over the hospital, there was a call went out for a plumber to report to Ward 2B. And they got rid of the baked beans and stopped up all the plumbing in the process. And we got very adept at finding ways to reduce the garbage. We would take the saltine cracker boxes and fill them with beets. No one liked beets. It was a very unpopular
so
item.
So you had all this extra garbage because the paraplegic.
Yeah, because they ate so little. And the Red Cross ladies would come in the afternoon and feed them cupcakes, and then they wouldn't want to eat their supper. But if we put the beets in the cracker boxes, then we could put them out in the waste paper, and they didn't get weighed. And so the next week, we got a letter from the commanding officer commending us for having the lowest rate of garbage of any ward in the hospital. And we stayed there as long as I was there. And no one ever questioned how you did it. You know, as long as it was right on paper, it didn't matter how you got through the results.
What about, I was wanted to ask you if you had any encounters with General Patton while you were at Walter Reed.
I did. I was at Walter Reed when the war ended, and it was protocol that when the generals came back from Europe, they go to see President Truman at the White House and then come to Walter Reed and call on General Pershing, the head man in World War I. For the day Eisenhower came, everyone was out in the halls. He shook hands with everyone. It was a very friendly time. The next week, General Patton came back, and the word was out that no one was to be in the halls. No one was to admit that he was there. The staff was to stay out of sight. And it happened that General Patton's son-in-law, Colonel Waters, was in the room next to my ward kitchen. And I went down the hall to visit a patient. As I came back, the door opened, and this little boy about four stuck his head out the door, and he said, "Bang, bang, I got you." And the four stars on the cap he was wearing on his head let me know that Grandpa was there seeing his son-in-law. I went down to my office, which I shared with a nurse, and clomp, 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 down the hall came these footsteps that could only be one person, and that was General Patton.
You saw a lot of interesting visitors who visited
Yes,
patients.
Because it was the Army Medical Center, everyone came to Walter Reed. Mrs. Roosevelt came one afternoon a week to see the boys. Every entertainer that you've ever heard of came to entertain them at night. And as members of the staff, we were all entitled to go. But we worked so hard. We always worked split shift, so it was a long, long day. And it was very intense work being with these men who were so seriously injured. So we very seldom took advantage of the opportunities to enjoy the stars that were there. The most impressive person I ever met was when I was at Kennedy General in Tennessee, and Helen Keller came to see the patients. And that was the most moving day that I ever had in the Army, when she would take her fingers and put them on the mouth of a blind patient and communicate with him. It was very touching to everybody there.
One thing that I remember in looking at your book is you said that people who worked on with paraplegics only had a 3-month assignment because it was such grueling.
Yes.
And you ended up doing it twice. Would you tell how that happened?
Well, the chief dietitian called me in and said, "Well, your time is up," and I never ask anyone to stay longer than that. That's such a difficult work. And then she brought out this petition, this scroll, and every patient on the ward had signed it and begged her to let me stay on. And so she said, "Well, I leave it up to you."
And you were just still recovering from hepatitis?
Well, that was just before I got hepatitis. Oh. Mm-hmm. And so, and maybe one of the reasons I was probably so run down that I was just, it was easy for the germs to get to me. But of course, I stayed.
Do you remember what you were doing when the war ended?
When the war ended, I was on duty at Walter Reed, and it was very interesting because it wasn't the big celebration to those patients that it was to everybody on the outside. Their lives were already shattered, and many of their buddies had been killed, and it was very subdued and very quiet. We didn't have the kind of a celebration that they did in many places.
Mm-hmm. Now, nowadays, years after the war, I know that you have been still playing.
Yes.
And you've been on our program, I think, 3 times,
yes,
a featured performer. And you're still entertaining people.
Yes, I still do.
And you have been involved, a charter member of the Military Women's Museum in Washington, D.C.?
Yes, the Women's Memorial in Washington, D.C.
And yes. What do they have there? It's a museum?
They have the records of all the women who have served in military, mm-hmm. From the beginning of the first service that was done many, many years ago. All those who have turned in their records. It's mm-hmm. a voluntary thing to turn your things, but they have
thousands.
I kept my dog tags in. We had to wear those every day.
And you have this beautiful album here that says U.S. Marine Corps. It's got March 8th, 1943 in your name down here.
Uh-huh.
And then you've written this book. I think you published it this year at 86.
Yeah.
I think you both are 86.
86.
For 2 more weeks.
And you recently were interviewed by someone for, a museum in North Carolina?
Well, I graduated from what was then the Woman's College at the University of North Carolina. It's now one of the branches of the University of North Carolina, Greensboro. And the archivist came out last Monday to spend the day with me, and we spent 4 hours doing an oral history. And then he said he would like any artifacts that I would like to give. And so he took back probably about 1,200 letters that I had used as the basis of the book. All the letters that I wrote home and letters that my mother and father and my brothers wrote to me. So I had a very complete record of life in the home front during the war and also in the service.
If thinking back now about those years, how does your memory view the whole picture and what would stand out the most in your mind?
We knew we were part of history. We knew, particularly being at Walter Reed, when I was seeing all those people every day. And I particularly remember the day that Roosevelt's body was going to be taken from the White House back to Hyde Park and standing in Lafayette Park, and had never before been in a situation where there were thousands of people crying and weeping. And it turned into a very embarrassing experience, because just as the caisson started to move down the drive and the Marine band was playing, and from up in a tree overhead, a voice called down, "Hey, dietitian, what's for breakfast?" And we got out of the there mighty fast.
Oh my goodness, that would stand out. What about you, Joe? Do you have anything that you would define your memories and experiences?
The patriotism that we felt and the love of our country and the love of our flag. Every morning at 8 o'clock sharp on every base, every U.S. military base, the flag goes up at 8 o'clock in the morning and comes down in the evening at sundown. But I still have that wonderful feeling of love of my country, and when I see that flag, it is emotional.
I'm very honored that you both came here to talk with me. I really appreciate it. It was very interesting, and thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. I know you enjoyed this program as much as I did. If you would like to acquire a tape or a DVD about this program or any others we have, you can contact us through the Cupertino Senior Center. That telephone number is 408-777-3150. We also have a website. It's www.thebetterpart.com. Thanks again, and we'll see you next time.